Hello, fellow students of Jewish history. I am so excited about the upcoming cruise on the Douro River. This will be my third time visiting the Douro with kosher riverboat cruises, and there are just so many amazing things there. And as I do my research into the people who live there and the stories that are told there, I'm just overwhelmed. Let me talk to you about one individual that I recently learned about. His name is Frey Diogo de Assumpçao. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. My Spanish and my Portuguese are not so great. But as you can tell from the word Frey, this is a friar. This is someone who actually became a Franciscan monk, and he ended up being burnt at the stake by the Inquisition. He's a great example of how, ironically, the Inquisition can sort of backfire. Let me tell you his story, which is really quite amazing. He was born in Viana, Portugal, which was just north of Porto, just a little bit beyond the Douro River Valley, in 1579. So the Inquisition had been in place for a good 50 years, and there was like no way for people to get real Jewish education, and no rabbis, and no Hebrew books other than what was allowed by the Inquisition, specifically medical textbooks. So, you know, there was a tremendous amount of energy devoted to extirpating Judaism, and the horrific auto da fe, the grand, you know, public burnings of people, and the purge-like atmosphere associated with the Inquisition was well underway, and in fact would be continuing for another 200 years in Portugal, and a little longer even in Spain. So this is the environment. Apparently, this young man had some Jewish background, although it would have been very, very minimal, because in the conviction document that we're going to look at in a second, it just refers to him having some Jewish blood, which is unusual because typically these conviction documents will say exactly how much Jewish blood, whatever that means exactly, like one grandparent, two grandparents, one great-great-grandparent, that kind of thing. So it's not clear whether he had any Jewish blood at all, although the Inquisition seems to think that there must have been some Jewish blood in there for him to take this particular route. At any rate, he was brought up as a pious Christian. He became a Franciscan friar, and he became fascinated with Judaism, perhaps because the Inquisition did everything it could to try and excoriate Judaism. He therefore got more and more interested in it. He ended up studying at the University of Salamanca, which was a tremendous center for crypto-Judaism. There are a lot of former Jews who are new Christians who studied at the University of Salamanca, many of whom were true believers in Christianity, and many of whom were just, you know, like pretending to get along so they could move ahead with their lives and so on. And they kept their Judaism either completely submerged, or they kept it active with other organizations.
The building right behind me was actually the base medrash of Salamanca. See, it's quite an imposing building. It has been reconstructed a few times since then and been remodeled, but essentially this is gives you a sense of the size and grandeur of the Jewish community up until the 14th and 15th century. Now, it happened that Salamanca was largely spared the depredations of the 1391 pogroms and mass conversions that we spoke about last night. But it took a little bit longer until Vicente Ferrer, one of the most important instigators of this violence, actually came to Salamanca and spent several months here. I have some ideas, some theories as to perhaps why Salamanca eventually converted en masse, but essentially at the beginning of the 15th century, you have a lot of Jews converting to Christianity at that time, and there was pressure to turn over the three synagogues in this town, and especially this base medrash, to the university. It was eventually handed over, as our wonderful guide Jose mentioned. It became a hostel, like in the sense of student hospitals, visiting student housing, and then later became a faculty of mathematics, linguistics, and now is the office of the rector, which is most amazing. And it is quite ironic that in the background here you see Friar Leon, who's one of the most famous figures from this university. He was, as we shall discuss tonight when we talk about crypto juice, he was actually a true believer. He was a new Christian whose ancestors were all Jews. His great grandmother was actually burned at the stake for refusing to give up Judaism. And he got into huge trouble with the Inquisition, primarily because he challenged the translations of the Latin Vulgate, which is the Bible that the Catholic Church was especially associated with. One of the verses that got him into trouble was actually read it last week. He translated the verse that speaks about the thing that the dove had in his mouth when he returned from the ark. And he referred to it with the Hebrew word leaf. And in fact, that is the Hebrew word. It says an olive leaf, but the Vulgate insists it was a branch, right? Like meaning a piece of wood. So for a couple of inches, literally, he was thrown in jail for how long? 4 years?
Four years and nine months.
Almost 5 years in jail for suggesting that the Hebrew might be more accurate than the later Latin translation. And when he came back, famously, he entered the classroom that hopefully we'll see inside. And he said, as we were saying, as if to say in a Jewish sense, like when you stop the shear and then you pick it up and you can say, Amar Rava. Okay, let's have a look inside.
Many Jewish families, crypto-Jewish families, would actually encourage one of the sons of the family to go into the church so that the rest of the family would have a reliable confessor to go to who could stand up for them and say, oh yeah, no, this person comes to confession all the time. They're definitely good Christians. At any rate, at the University of Salamanca, he became completely interested in Judaism, and he ended up deciding he was going to leave Christianity and he would flee to England, where he would adopt Judaism, perhaps to Belgium, but in the end he was caught by the Inquisition and put on trial. Now, here's an especially interesting thing about his particular story. He was, you know, I'll give away the ending. He was unfortunately burned at the stake in 1603. He was 24 years old. But what was especially noteworthy about his case is that his conviction was written, but never disseminated. We know it existed because a few decades later, the great writer Manasseh ben Israel, a scholar of Amsterdam, of actually a Portuguese Jewish extraction, mentions that he has it, but that document was lost for several hundred years. It only turned up in the British Museum when it was discovered by Lionel David Barnett at the beginning of the 20th century, and he published an article on it with the original Portuguese in 1924 in the Jewish Quarterly Review. And I'm going to show you some sections from that. So why was this conviction of Assumpçao not circulated? Primarily because it included a blistering critique of Christianity, that when they were interrogating him, he talked about all the reasons why he wanted to become a Jew and why he wanted to abandon Christianity. And it was so heated that, you know, there's no way, although they had to record these things in order to justify the conviction, they simply couldn't publish it, because then all kinds of people would get even more ideas. So this is how the Inquisition kind of, like, you know, sort of created its opposite effect. The inquisitors, at the end of this lengthy discussion with him, in which not only did he indicate that, you know, things like the cross is just a couple of sticks, whew, can you imagine how they would have felt, that the Sabbath really was on Saturday, not on Sunday. And in fact, while he was in jail, he tried to keep the Sabbath. He tried to keep kosher in jail and fasting and all kinds of things like that. And they ended up, of course, the inquisitors condemned him. And at the end of this condemnation, they utter this stock phrase, which appears at the end of almost all of these condemnations, that the church excommunicates him completely, but they beg that the secular authorities not proceed to the penalty of death or the shedding of blood. This is, by the way, how the Inquisition would work, that typically the church would make the decision, and then they would so-called relax the person to the secular authorities, who would decide what they were going to do. Then, of course, the secular authorities would decide whatever they wanted, and in many cases, they would burn the individual at the stake. The secular authorities would occasionally offer a small mercy by garroting the individual, meaning strangling them before they set them on fire. But the church would also engage through the secular authorities of the burning of, you know, people in effigy, or having their bones unearthed and then burned. And at the end, of course, all of the property of the victim would go to the royal chamber, which was part of the profit incentive of this. A certain amount would also go to the church. A certain amount would also go to the people who denounced them. So it was definitely economically a self-sustaining kind of enterprise. At any rate, This entire document is recorded, and then there's a little note because it's transcribed by a Jewish writer. Phrases added after the name of the justices, may the Lord destroy them, and may God give vengeance to the penitent for his blood. Amen and amen. Wow, chilling. Now, this particular story reverberated throughout early 17th century Europe, so much so that it motivated secret societies in the name of Saint Assumpçao in places like Coimbra, where there was a large contingent of people who felt very much like this particular individual. Fascinating story. We're going to see many of these stories along the Douro River and see where they happened and get a sense for what that difficult period must have been like. I hope you'll have the opportunity to join me on this cruise, but if not, really looking forward to sharing with you our discoveries on this channel. Thank you very much for watching.